بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل كل يعمل على شاكلته فربكم أعلم بمن هو أحد سبيلا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. اللهم صل على Cultivating a divine disposition is our topic in this year's Ashra. Tonight is lecture number 2. Before I begin tonight's discussion, I wanted to express a little bit of gratitude. I want to say thank you for those people who messaged me last night telling me that they love their wife and they're happy in their marriages and they're raising great kids. I got a lot of messages last night. I appreciate that. It really makes life a lot easier in this world when you and your spouse are on the same page together. It makes everything almost not bearable when you two are not on the same page. So may Allah increase that love between all of you, inshallah, and all of you have this loving, comforting home. For that, one loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Yesterday, I got right into the topic of Shakila. Our discussion is revolving around the 84th verse of the 17th chapter of the glorious Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Holy Prophet, tell them, قُلْ كُلٌ يَعْمَلُ عَلَى شَاكِلَتِهِ, that everybody, and the way that we know that he's talking about human beings is by the 82nd verse and the 83rd verse and the 85th verse. If you look at those verses, if I had more time, if I had more nights, I would go through those verses, but I don't have that type of time. Allah's entire discussion in those verses is surrounding around human beings. He says to the Prophet, tell them everybody will act according to something known as a shakila. To the point where Allah, now your Rabb, will know, a'lamu, he'll be the best to know, who amongst them are the best guided sabila, on the path. This usage of the word, this Qurani istilah of shakila, has to be understood. And so like I said last night, we're going to spend 10 nights, 10 hours almost, dissecting one word of the Quran. That's the depth of the Quran. Yesterday, I tried to make a link and I don't know how successful I was. So I wanna make sure that I kind of firm that up before I move on. I also know I went way too long last night and that won't happen again this Ashra, I promise. But I tried to make that connection between the opening verses of Surah Yasin about this nation in Qawm the Prophet has sent to warn, who has not been warned before, and who didn't heed the warning, ignored the warning of the Holy Prophet, believed, لَقَدْ حَقَّ الْقَوْلُ, that whatever we were heard or whatever we were told before is truth and haq. We don't need you to come and tell us that this zamana, this era, this nation that we live in is different. It's not different according to us. We will do as our fathers did and we'll be successful. In the process, Allah says, because you choose now, and that's one thing I forgot to mention last night, because it could seem very, very evil of God, na'udhu billah, that he would put shackles on someone's chain, or he would make them blind in their hearts internally, or close off or seal their hearts, when in reality, this is the path that they chose. If someone chooses a certain path, no matter how much God tries to convince them or inspire them, they're not going to listen. So Allah says, in actuality, they're the ones that sealed their own hearts. They're the ones that put chains and shackles on their neck. And because they weren't able to recognize the time that they lived in, they weren't able to pick up the processes and the various tools that they need to safeguard their deen. Today we live in a completely different era than any other era out there. Even me growing up in this city was a different era back then as opposed to now. And those of us who don't believe that, we're in for a rude awakening. And because we live in a different era, we have to search out tools sent down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to once again what? Regain the narrative, reclaim the narrative, regain control, be able now to sit there and tell ourselves what path I'm on. Don't let anyone else dictate to me what path I'm on. Because the reality is that, as many ulama have said, our lives are somewhat hijacked right now. We're being told what to wear. We're being told what to eat. We're being told what to post. We're being told how spiritual we are, how beautiful we are, how accepted we are by people who have no business taking part in these types of conversations. And so one such tool that the Quran talks about is this shakila. Now, we have to define this term. It's a very difficult translation, and one that I have to get through today. So please bear with me as we get through a technical conversation that later on will happen. Let me give you a little bit of the journey of where I'm about to take all of you in the next 8 or 9 nights, whether you like it or not, you're with me. So after we identify the word shakla, I will say this word so many times, it'll be drilled in your head. I want you to know what shakla is. Shakla, shakla, shakla. I want you to name your kids shakla. I want a message saying that, Malana, mashallah, we were blessed with a daughter. Shakila Kanji was born this morning. 8 pounds, 7 ounces. Mother and baby are doing well. If you have a restaurant, I want your main dish to be shakila. Best shakila in town. Shakila. Okay? If you ask what was said us as topic in JCC, just say what? Shakila. Whether you know it or not, I don't care. Just get the term down right. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The problem is it has multiple definitions. So today I have to go through the idea of what is it that what definition I want to use. Not it's mine, but what is it that I think, what the ulama now have thought, that this definition is the most proper definition. Our Sunni Mufassirin have defined this term. Many of our Shias have defined this term. And sometimes it's not a one-word term. Now, the what term I will use in English interchangeably is disposition. Okay? We say mizaj in Urdu, character. Not even behavior. Behavior is one step beneath disposition. Behavior is one thing, disposition is another. Khulq is one thing, malaka is another. Because if these types of verses, and specifically this one, gets in the wrong hands, it can be used to really what? Argue against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's very easy that a person who is a transgender can come and grab this verse and throw it in my face. Sayyid, all I'm doing is acting on my disposition. I believe I should have been a woman, and so I'm simply doing what the Quran is asking me to do. Ya'amulu ala shakilatihi. I'm acting on my shakila. Right? So that's a dangerous discussion now. Let's make sure we are on the same page moving forward. Before I do that, if I can ask you from now to move a little bit forward, people are rolling in, mashallah, with one loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ya Ali, ya Ali. Mashallah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. The word shakila in Arabic has been defined by the ulama of Lughat. Some ulama, I tell you, have done incredible work for us in the Islamic world. One such work that I think goes unnoticed are Quranic dictionaries. Quranic linguistic books. Imagine the amount of effort that it takes to take a verb in the Quran, find its mustard, its huruf asli, its actual source, and then be able to identify the various meanings from the very rich Arabic language, and then somehow now try to understand through various other ahadith and verses what this instance of this verb meant in this verse. That's hard. It's a lifelong effort. We have many books like that. One such book of Raghib Isfahani and Mufradat is a book that Hawza uses a lot. Allama Tabatabai has a very detailed tafsir of this verse. And I ask all of you who are looking for source of my content in this ashra or want to learn more about what? About Shakila. Shakila is Alama's tafsir. Almizan.org, almizan.org is an English translation of parts of tafsir, Almizan. Alhamdulillah, the parts that we're talking about have been translated very well online. It's a very easy, user-friendly site, drop-down boxes, chapters, verses, blah, blah, blah. And if you can at home, go to that website, look up this verse, and you'll see what I'm talking about. He says, and he quotes Raghib Isfahani, Raghib says that shakila means to tie something together. Okay? It comes from shakal. Shakal in Urdu and Farsi means someone's form or someone's shape. The Arabs would use something to tie their animals, right? Some say a shakil it's referred to. That you would bound the animal by this tool so it wouldn't move. And Alama makes that transition to say that we are also bound by our disposition. We are tied by our disposition. Now one has to understand, how do we get to disposition? Number two, are there various aqsam and categories of shakila? Number three, and more importantly, how do I change if I can't even change? Because there are some things that are not in my control. I talked about last night, for example, if you come from a family that's very angry, right? The nature is very angry. Your genetics are, let's say, A, you're bound by those genes. Can I change those genes? I have no control of those genes. I said, bye. I didn't have a say in them. I was born into this family, this khandan, this extended family, blah, blah, blah. How much is in our control? How much is not in our control? All that we have to discuss today to move forward. Because there are some people that will take this verse to mean compulsion. There are some people that would say that the zalimeen of the past were simply acting on their disposition. Fine, they had an evil disposition. They had an evil shakila. And all they were doing was they were acting on it. Okay? And the Quran says, كُلُّ يَعْمَلُ عَلَى شَاكِلَتِي. It doesn't even describe what shakila you'll act on. It just says everybody will act on their disposition. Which means that all Yazid was doing was acting out on a Quranic verse. Do you see how peachy day it gets? How deep and amik it gets? How we have to understand moving forward as a community, what is it I want to establish? And then based on that, the next 7-8 discussions will go back to this one today. So it's very important. Because eventually we want to get to factors that can help me what? Help me better my disposition, build my disposition. As I said in the title, cultivate my disposition. Towards what? A godly one, a divine one. And then act on that disposition. Is that even possible? Let's establish that tonight with one loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So we know that when someone reaches a level where an act is part of their disposition, and I will translate in English, disposition, those things that we do without thinking about it, okay? They come natural to us. Good or bad. By the way, I have not described good or bad. Taghuti, satanic, divine, godly. All that, I have not defined that. I simply say there's a nature inside of us, and God says that you are sometimes bound by that nature. And that's why change is so very hard. As you get older, you're what? You're sort of engraving those acts inside of your soul. Along comes me, asking you at the age of 50, 60 to wipe that clean and start fresh, not impossible, right? Not mahal, but mumkin, but possible. Not impossible, but possible, okay? So disposition comes after behavior. Behavior, when it's repeated time and time again, it becomes part of your disposition. So follow me in the beginning of tonight's lecture as I go through a little bit of a quick chain to get to the point of disposition through the English lens a little bit, okay? If you've taken any foundational theology courses through me or through others, this chain will be familiar to yourself. When something gets engraved inside of you to the point where you can't help yourself, there are people who they try to fight their nature, their urge, their inclination, but they can't. I'm sorry, I can't remain quiet here, Asad Bhai. So I'm gonna get on the mic, I'm gonna email, I'm gonna call them. I'm sorry, I heard your story, I couldn't sit there and do nothing. I had to come and help you. Those are people who are bound by what? By their shakila. But that doesn't come in one instance. A person who gets upset in the parking lot for the first time in their life is not somebody who is intrinsically angry. No. There has to be takrar. There has to be a repetition of behavior. Has to be a pattern of behavior where this individual now is constantly showing the same behavior to the point now where they go from smoking one cigarette to becoming a smoker. Where they go from, let's say, for example, to having a good day with God to becoming a believer in God. Because the problem is that sometimes we think that when a person has a bad day in terms of their acts, that's who they are. And what I'm trying to establish, and it'll take me a couple of days, I think, with all of you to establish that. I told you it's a difficult ashra for me. What I'm trying to establish is the difference between one act and the actor, between the fa'il and the fa'il. There's a massive difference between the two. A lot of us focus on the act of the person, not the person themselves. And all the act is simply a reflection of the person it is. Look, inside philosophy, they have categories of wujud. If you've done any reading on philosophy, you've heard of these terms, right? Mumkin al-wujud, wajib al-wujud, mumtana al-wujud. One of them is al-wujud al-mir'ati. Al-wujud al-mir'ati is a reflective existence. For example, a what? A mirror, exactly. A mirror. The only job of a mirror is to reflect what's in front of it. If nothing is in front of it, it won't reflect anything. It's not possible that I stand in front of the mirror, it shows me my wife's reflection. It's not possible that I'm sitting there and I'm trying to fix my hair before the majlis and it shows me someone else's hair. It will reflect exactly what's in front of me. I am the cause, it simply is the effect. If there is no illat, there's no ma'lul coming from the mirror. All it is a reflective existence that is what? That is dominantly expecting of a cause, okay? Without a cause, it can't exist. We use this term sometimes in the world of akhlaq. The ulama of akhlaq teach our believers, you and I, to don't have this wujud inside of your akhlaq. Don't simply be a reflection of the akhlaq in front of you. Okay? If the person is great, you become great. If the person is soft-spoken, you also become soft-spoken. If the person is ignorant, you show your ignorance. Angry, spewing fire, you spew fire as well. No. The Ahlul Bayt didn't have that existence. They had their own akhlaq. No matter what the person in front of them, no matter what cause they were, they showed their own illat and their own effect. That's hard. It's very hard to maintain the effect of your akhlaq when the person in front of you is showing something else. But shakila and your disposition and your fi'l and your acts are nothing but a reflection of who you are on the inside. You end up knowing who somebody is by what they do. And they do what they do based on who they are. Okay? Reflective. Now you can choose, I can choose to fix the fi'l, or I can choose to fix the fa'il. I can choose the act, I can choose to fix the act or fix the doer of the act. And here the Quran is saying, forget the act will always be there. As long as the doer is corrupt, the act will be corrupt. If the doer is good, the act will be good. So focus on the fa'il. And in this ashra, the fa'il is you and I. You and I are the doer of the acts. And we'll talk about the idea of how can we cultivate that inside of our children, inside of ourselves, inside of our students. All that is coming later on in the Ashura. We have to first establish the idea that this is a reflective existence. Point number one. Point number two is that why is this discussion important today? And everything that we are facing today, why did I choose this discussion? And I'll tell you why in a moment. I'll tell you why right now, actually. Look, there are two approaches. There's a lot happening outside right now. A lot happening outside of us. We're very, very scared for our own iman, the iman of our children. We're very scared. The transgender movement, the alphabet family, everything, individualism, all out there and strong. Especially in this country, very liberal. Liberal democracy right now shoving itself down our throat. It's now aiming at our children inside of our schools, in our books, in our curriculums, right? It'll seep its way into our mosque, maybe on our minbar, right? And the approach is twofold, if you ask me. And by all means, please come and see me if you don't agree. I don't mind. The first of the approaches is a very defensive one. As you come up, you knock them down. As they come up, you debate them and knock them down. As they come up, you approach them and you wait. And as they come up, you jab. As you come up, you jab. That's one approach. The other approach is not defensive. It's not defa'i in nature. It's offensive in nature. I don't mean offensive outside of you. I mean offensive inside of you. And follow the example for a moment. Before I went for my first Hajj in 2017, I was given glorious advice. My brother Akil Karim, if he's here, mashallah, thank you very much, Akil Bhai. Akil Bhai told me one thing. After your first tawaf, Sayyid, go up to the third floor, the highest floor of the mosque, and look down on what you just performed. Why, Akil Bhai? He goes, you'll know. I said, okay. I mentioned this before, this is an example, but I want you to understand why I chose this topic. Because you've seen topics floating around on Instagram of all the other ulama, and they are also attacking, they're also approaching this subject in various ways. This was my approach. Let me first, for the sake of the crowd, understand or explain to all of you why I chose it and then move on. So he says, go to the top floor. So I went. First, I did my tawaf, and my first tawaf, I remember, and my umat tamattu was a very difficult tawaf, ya Allah. I couldn't wait. Tawaf of the Kaaba, let's do this, let's go in my ahram, blah, blah, blah. And I enter the first thing and I get the first elbow in my ribs. And it wasn't someone's elbow, it was somebody's, I think, forehead in my rib or something, or somebody, because I'm just like. And then I get somebody just beaming right across from me. Somebody else beaming right across from me. I get the elbow on my shoulder and I just kept telling myself, left shoulder to the Kaaba. Left shoulder to the Kaaba. That's it. Just get through seven rounds. With every poke, I'm like, And my blood pressure, mashallah, is rising. Labbaik, Allahumma labbaik. Right? Getting upset. Trying my best to be patient. Following people who, oh, this person elbowed me, that person elbowed me, you know, this and that. Okay? Took me 4 or 5 attempts at tawaf to really understand why tawaf was so recommended. That's how kamzarf I am. My capacity is low. My tawaf is done. I'm done my tawaf. I did exactly after my umrah tamattu, I went up. Please follow the example. Once I went up, my entire vision changed. Now I saw one movement around the Kaaba, and I saw the Kaaba for what it was. And he told me, just look at the Kaaba. Kaaba, you see this motion going around the Kaaba. I couldn't see faces, I couldn't make out heights and weights, I couldn't make out nationalities, I couldn't tell male or female, I just saw this one movement around the Kaaba. The person who elbowed me, I forgot about. The person who headbutted me, I forgot. The person whose elbow, I forgot. I forgot these brothers and those brothers. I forgot the chain, I forgot all that. I forgot everything, and I remembered why I was here. But it took elevation to do that. When I was down there, every little nook in my ribs was, every little nook in my ribs. Now, I could sit there and grab every person, please, brother, maintain your clock. Please, brother, maintain your clock. Stop poking people. Stop bumping the people. Slow down, brother. Don't zigzag. We're all this together. We're all Allah's believers. I can do that. Defensive, jab, jab, defensive. I can do that, or I can elevate to the third floor and remind myself why I'm here. The next time now I went to tawaf, a little bit less, the fifth or sixth time, you can jab me all you want. I wouldn't feel it. We're being jabbed. We're being jabbed by a lot of groups, in this country especially. And if you know anything about boxing or kickboxing, and there are a few of you now who train, you know there are two types of training. The training is that the teacher will tell you how to jab. And because my cross is my right hand, my jab is my left. So there's two types of training here. Follow me, please. One is offensive, where you see an opening, jab, 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 cross. Jab, cross, whatever the case may be. The second type of training is that you have to what? Be tolerant towards the pain. Tire the enemy out. Muhammad Ali's victory against George Foreman was not supposed to be a victory. It wasn't a victory. They called him crazy. Foreman was a beast. Ali was in his latter stages inside of his career. But he didn't take on the jab, jab, jab philosophy. He what? He became tolerant to the jab itself. He closed in, rope-a-dope, and he tired George Foreman out. Once he was tired, then he went and said, okay, that's it. We can choose now, as these things pop up, to smash them down. And I hate to use this horrible carnival example. There's a game, right? You have a hammer. As the thing pops up, you hit it, and you hit it, and you hit it, and you hit it, and you hit it. Right? That game? Don't look at me like I'm talking French up here, please. You guys have all been there, right? Yes? Hoo-ha, hoo-ha. Yes, you've been there? Yeah, you hit as it comes up? Yeah. Why are you looking at me like I'm up here talking Russian to you guys here? Right? You hit it. Like, not us. We don't go to carnivals. Astaghfirullah. Right? We stay home and do tasbih of Allah. Good for you. I go to carnivals with my kids. Okay? Bam, 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 bam. Right? And then you're waiting. That's one approach. The problem is that there'll be 10 today and 1,000 tomorrow. Or the approach is to build yourself so strong that any jab is not felt anymore. To build your chakra to the point where it's godly in nature. And once it's divine in nature, anything that's not divine is irrelevant. Doesn't have an impact. That's what we're trying to achieve in this ashra. Cultivating a divine disposition. Going higher, seeing the Kaaba, ignoring the elbows and the ribs. We're trying to get to that stage. We can get there. We have to understand how to get there. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, please.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Please, can I ask brothers to stand and move forward? We have brothers still coming in. Please stand with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad and move forward, please. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
I thought my time was up. I was like, oh, ya Allah. I was like, ooh, it's a new one. Oh, there's lots of people there. Ya Allah, please come. MashaAllah. Ya Ali, Ya Ali. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
So to get to a level where something is part of your disposition, you have to go through a series of events. There has to be a thought. There has to be inclination towards a thought. Then acting on that inclination. Then repeating that act to the point it becomes part of your akhlaq, and then becomes part of your disposition. It took the Prophet 40 years to convince the people of Mecca he was Sadiq and Amin. The ulama say do an act for 40 days straight, it becomes part of your shakila. Doesn't happen overnight. You can't, there was one brother told me that I've been praying Salat now for 7 days, Mulana. Why can't I see people's barzakh? Oh, yo. Slow down. People's barzakh. 7 days of Salat. 7 days of Salat. So we're in a hurry. We're in a rush. And this is not a rushing process. So this comes from repeated behavior. If I want to establish something khair and good inside of me, I have to do it consistently. That's why Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, Allahumma salli ala. He says that amal that you do, albeit small, but consistently, is more beloved in the eyes of Allah than large acts of worship done inconsistently. I'm sorry, what's easy is the once a lifetime hajj. Save for a couple of years, go for hajj, come back, we're done. What's hard is the everyday small acts of worship, the everyday salat, the everyday akhlaq, the everyday mubarizah and muraqabah with shaitan. That's very difficult. But that's the consistency that you need to get to your shakila. It's not an overnight pill. It's not one verse. I read a juz today, I should be able to see now the way that Imam Ali's. No, hold on 1 second. That's point number two now. My last point I want to make today, and then Masaib. This is not a godless process. The criteria and the mi'yar is God. God is not saying in the Quran in this verse that those that commit evil acts are those that are just bound by the disposition. So they're not to be blamed. In the beginning I mentioned, this is not void of free will. Alama says in his tafsir that what this verse is alluding to is that there is a tendency inside of you, what's called iqtida in the world of theology, or insan chinasi, anthropology. Iqtida means that there is an inclination inside of you and a tendency inside of you. If that inclination is towards corruption and satanic acts and sue and evil, that's your jihad and your struggle. If that iqtida is towards goodness, that's tawfiq ilahi. We don't deny in Islam that people sometimes have inclinations towards evil acts. Again, I go back to my 2020 ashra. Social justice, the COVID era, this hall was empty. Of the 10 nights, I spent 3 nights on the Masumin member, if you remember. The baked chicken example. Right? Shakila, you'll remember. Baked chicken, you remember. Everything else, yeah. In that 3 mini-series, I talked about the necessity for evil. Why shaitan must exist to reach God. There has to be an animal inside of us to what? Discover the angel inside of us. There has to be a hayvan inside of us to understand divinity inside of us. I can only be praised for reaching a destination when there were paths that were there that would deviate me off the path. All right? If it's a one-way street to heaven, I get to heaven, I'm like, yeah, I made it to heaven. Great. That's not kamal, nor is that qabil ta'rif. It's not. I'm sorry. There's no sort of prize for that. All you did was you followed one-way arrows. Good for you. If there was a fork in the road, you chose the right path, then you're worthy of praise. But the fork in the road has to exist. There is absolutely inclinations for evil inside of us. There is a possibility and an imkan of what a shakilaya su, a shakilaya taghuti, a satanic disposition. We have to fight that. Because those who believe in alternative lifestyles, those who love the alphabet, are those individuals who will sit there and argue that I have tendencies towards one lifestyle. I have tendencies towards one gender. And now I'm simply fulfilling that iqtida inside of me. And we don't sit there and we don't deny those tendencies. There are men who've been raised by women, surrounded by 4 sisters. mother and her sisters and khalas and female cousins and blah, blah, blah. They have female tendencies. That's just the effect of their environment. Father was around, but not very much so. This person was affected by the females around them. Sit in their circles, do what they were doing, and they were raised in that environment. They have this inclination towards things that, quote unquote, are female, if I can even say that nowadays. I'm not canceled by tomorrow. Then there are those people that are inclined, are raised by boys and men, our sisters, all brothers, all uncles, right? The tomboy of today. They prefer to sit there and throw the football around than to do something else. They prefer to play baseball with your friends than do something else. That's called iqtida. There's inclination. There's tendency. There's no doubt about that. Islam does not deny that. That's cause and effect. But if you are going towards that and you think that God now made a mistake, and because I can hit a home run further than my brother, I should have been born a male. Whoa. Slow your roll. Hold on one second. That leap is a very tough leap. That's where that struggle is. That's where that jihad is. There are people who are inclined towards music, inclined towards gambling, inclined towards food when they are stressed out. If you're trying to lose weight and your moment or your method of comfort is food, then your jihad is to not do that, right? But you're inclined towards it. Inside, you have this tendency. Allah does not say, well, because it's there, act on it. You have to. You have no choice. That's not what God is saying. Allah makes that very clear. There are some things that are not in your control. You were born in a family with certain genetics. That's fine. But what is afzal over that? What's over that is the idea that you have very much control over your own moral developments. This is not stripping you of free will. It's not that all because I'm inclined towards something, I must act on it. In fact, the very nature of a mujahid is one who's inclined towards something but pulls themselves back. That's a mujahid fi sabilillah. That's an individual now who is fighting on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the jihad akbar that Allah talks about. This major, major war. Not a battlefield. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So let's not be confused. Let's not think, wait a second, say this verse says that you have to act on. No, there's no force in this verse. In fact, the verse says, understand the power of your shakila. To go against your shakila is very difficult. And tomorrow, inshallah, we'll talk about the injustice against shakila. There are people who are good-natured people, and they don't like to be individuals who act on that good nature for whatever purpose there may be. Then there are people that are evil in nature, and they put on this front outside of them. Right? There's an injustice. We'll talk about that tomorrow, inshallah. But please, let's understand. Shakila meaning disposition, mizaj, behavior. That disposition comes from pattern of behavior. That's why change is so hard and so revered in Islam. If you look at those groups that showed any form of islah in Islam, they were rewarded. People of Medina, islah, they had the Holy Prophet. People of Kufa refused for islah. And you know their history. So let's not be confused. And this is why we can't simply look at the Quran as a what? As an apparent meaning. We don't believe as Shias that everything is only face value. No, there's layers and layers and layers to the Quran. On the zahir, the verse says, act on your disposition, khalas. Wait a second, there's a lot more to that. But know that when you have worked so hard, like many of you have, to have a divine disposition, acting on that is very, very easy. Think about two sets of people, okay? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. There's somebody right now in your mind you can think of who has a divine disposition, who is a very, a very faithful believer, okay? Think about the most faithful believer that you know. Person who can do no wrong in the world, very godly, very religious, very spiritual, okay? In your mind, that's that person. Okay? Some of you are like, oh, me, mashallah. Now think about the fact if someone comes to you and reports to you that that person in your mind was seen in a bar. Your first instinct should be, I think maybe you have him mistaken for somebody else. Or maybe he was there to use the phone. Or maybe he was there for something else. You give him excuses upon excuses. Why? You know his divine disposition is just that, divine. His acts will what mirror that divine disposition? Now think about that person that maybe is not so religious. Maybe a person doesn't really care about what kind of life they live, and they're found in a bar. Like, yeah, of course. Where else would he be found? Of course. Does that surprise you? Oh, you should have seen that guy blew up at the mosque. Who was it? It was so-and-so. Oh, him. Yeah, he blows up every Thursday. Or him, are you sure? He never gets angry. It's a reflective wujud. And that's why we have to make sure the illat is right, so the ma'lul gets purified. The person is beautiful on the outside of the mirror will reflect that beauty. It's not like if I have a nice fade before Muharram, and I did, mashallah. Lined up my beard, all for you. I stand in front of a mirror, it won't give me the ugly face I had the week before. It'll give me my nice fade and my lineup on my beard. So that's what shakila is. Let's understand what shakila is. Now, are there factors that help me build this divine disposition? Absolutely. And that's what the crux of our ashra will be. What are those external factors and internal factors? That's where now the discussion takes off from tomorrow, inshallah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Because there were people who tried to stop Imam Hussein. I said that last night. To the point where they question Imam Hussein's wisdom. Why are you going? With women, with children. It's Yazid. Are you okay? And he would be bound by his shakula. I can't sit there and watch a man like that, who kills innocent lives and drinks alcohol, claim to be a numainda or representation of my Nana Rasulullah. He was bound by it, Hussein was. And that's the process he left behind for you and I to follow. And on this night, I want to remember that moment where now he's leaving the beloved city of Medina. I don't know how many of you understand even that statement alone. I'm attached to this city. I've had many chances to leave this city. I just can't. It's my beloved Toronto. I'll always chant for the Leafs. That's my Bimari. What do I do? This was the city of not only his family, but his Nana Rasulullah. Ran in the cities, in the streets of this city. And now he has to leave this city. The caravan now is getting ready to leave Medina. Imam Hussein makes his way towards the grave of Rasulullah. There's two stops that he made, of many, but two stops I want to mention tonight. One stop is when he went to the grave of Rasulullah, and one stop is when he said his goodbye to his mother, Fatima Zahra. Two different relationships. Two different forms of Hussein. He marched towards Rasulullah. And the man on a mission, stern, strong, committed, ready. Nana, I'm leaving Medina now. Your ummah needs a reform in Islam. I'm going to reform the nation of yours. They've deviated. they've accepted him as their Khalifa. Like a soldier to his captain, almost saluting him, saying, I'm going. But when he went to his mother Fatima, Hussein was different. There were moments of weakness, for lack of a better word, and I'm sorry to use that word, for someone as valiant as Imam Hussein. There were two moments that break my heart that showed me that there is a human side, if I can use that word, for Imam Hussein. One was when he was approaching his mother. One was when he let Ali Akbar go to the Maidan of Karbala. And both of them are very similar. In what way? Ali Akbar now mounts the horse. He says every so often, Hussein, Ali Akbar, when you can go inside the Maidan of Karbala, just turn your face towards me so I can be told who I'm going towards. Ali Akbar now enters the Maidan of Karbala, but he sees that there's somebody behind him. He looks behind him, a 57-year-old father stumbling behind the horse of Ali Akbar, getting up and falling, getting up and falling. Ali Akbar gets off the horse. Baba, you gave me ijazat, Baba. That same Hussein now is leaving Medina, walking towards his mother, stumbling towards his mother's grave. Amma, I'm leaving Medina now, Amma. I'm leaving Medina now, Amma. Just take me into your arms. Let me know everything will be all right. Hussein says his khulafisi, and now the qafilas are ready. The caravans are ready. All the men now are there. Everyone is loading up the luggage. Out come the women. Out come the children. And then a voice can be heard. A voice can be heard. Everyone, please move back. Lower your gaze. Zainab, the daughter of Ali, is coming out of her home. All the men now move back. All the men lower their gaze. Zainab comes. Kishan says she comes, Zainab. Ali Akbar is there. Abbas is there. Honor Muhammad are there. Hussein is there. Let me go ahead and mount you on this camel, Zainab. All of her soldiers, all of her lions are there to welcome the daughter of Fatima. This beautiful individual now, with so much respect now, she's mounted onto her camel, moving towards Karbala. And now take your hearts to the 11th of Muharram, after Shami Ghariba. This qafla once again now is ready to move towards Kufa and Sham. All the women are there. All the children are there. Zainab is standing there. Umm Kulsum is standing there. She mounts Umm Kulsum on the camel. Zainab stands there by herself. Hey Zainab, that was Medina. This is Karbala. There is no Ali Akbar. There is no Hussein. Matame Hussein, ya Hussein, ya Hussein. Ya Hussein, ya Hussein, ya